Okay, thank you and welcome to the 26th meeting of Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. We have no apologies for today's meeting. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence from stakeholders as part of our pre-budget scrutiny and I refer members to papers 2 and 3. And I welcome to the meeting Susan McKellar, Manager of the Scottish Women's Convention, Claire Gallagher, Human Rights Officer at the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisations Scotland, Julian Matthew, Senior Manager, Performance Audit and Best Value at Audit Scotland, Sarah Cowan, Coordinator for the Scottish Women's Budget Group, Alan Falds, Policy and Information Officer, Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland, known as the Alliance, and joining us online, Una Brown, Human Rights Programme Lead at the Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities, and Callum Chomsky, National Director, Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland, who is also joining us virtually. So you're all very, very welcome. We'll start, I think, by inviting witnesses to make short opening statements in turn. There's a lot of witnesses today, so if we could keep the statements reasonably brief, please. And if we could start with Susan McKellar, please.
I'm Susan McKellar. I'm the manager from the Scottish Women's Convention. We take the views of women throughout Scotland and put their views into policy and legislation.
Thank you. And Claire Gallagher.
Hi. Thank you very much for inviting me here today. My name is Claire Gallagher. I'm the Human Rights Officer at the Council of Ethnic Minority Voluntary Sector Organisations, otherwise known as CEMVO Scotland. CEMVO Scotland is a national intermediary organisation and a strategic partner of the Scottish Government's Directorate of Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights. We aim to develop the capacity and the sustainability of the ethnic minority sector and its communities. With a network of over 600 organisations, we gather intelligence on issues affecting communities and use that to inform policy and practice. Within CEMVO Scotland, we offer an array of different programmes, ranging from employment to financial capability. And one of our core programmes is the Race for Human Rights programme, which I work on. The aim of this programme is to embed equality and human rights into the strategic planning and day-to-day functions of public bodies and third sector organisations, and we do this by adopting a human rights-based approach. We offer consultancy support, policy reviews, training and workshops and learning webinars. Thank you.
Thank you. And Gillian Matthew.
Morning. Gillian Matthew from Audit Scotland. I'm a senior manager in our Performance Audit and Best Value group. We audit over 220 public bodies across all sectors to ensure that public money is spent effectively and efficiently and also to support improvement as well. We're independent from all the bodies that we audit, including the Scottish Government, which is really important. And within Performance Audit and Best Value, we do value national audits, value for money, looking at use of resources, service performance and sustainability. And the joint response that we written response that we gave to the committee was a joint response from Audit Scotland, the Auditor General, and the Accounts Commission, who we do work on behalf of. That's all I'll say. That's a short intro. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Sarah Cowan.
Hi, I'm Sarah Cowan, the coordinator of the Scottish Women's Budget Group. We advocate for gender equality through gender budgeting to recognise the different economic realities of women and men, and taking a gender analysis approach to budgets helps improve understanding of how decisions affect women and men differently because of their different experience in family and household structures, in paid employment and unpaid work, and caring and providing support to others. And we provide training on gender budgeting and do advocacy and research.
Thank you. And Alan Falds.
Thank you. Good morning. I'm Alan Falds, a Policy and Information Officer at the Health and Social Care Alliance Scotland. The Alliance is the national third sector intermediary for a range of health and social care organisations, a membership of over 3,000 that also includes, in addition to third sector organisations, large and small, private sector, statutory sector and a range of individuals with lived experience. We have a vision for a Scotland where everybody, and in particular disabled people, people living with long-term conditions and unpaid carers, are able to realise their right to live well, are able to have services that put them at the centre, that support them to live their lives to the best extent possible. As part of that, we don't just look at health and social care, but also related areas like social security. We've taken a look at climate change, 20-minute neighbourhoods, gambling harms, and of course, all of that's underpinned by human rights. And the Alliance has been a long-standing advocate for adopting a human rights budgeting approach within Scotland's budget processes.
Thank you. And going online now to Una Brown, please.
Hi there. Thank you, committee members, for having me here today. My name is Una Brown. I am Human Rights Programme Lead at the Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities. The Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities' vision is for a fairer Scotland, where people with learning disabilities live full, safe, loving and equal lives. We're a human rights defender, working to uphold, protect and raise awareness of the human rights issues facing people with learning disabilities in Scotland. I welcome the opportunity to give evidence today, and in particular, I would be keen to highlight the need for improved disability disaggregated data to ensure people with learning disabilities are visible in legislation, policy and decision-making. The need to ensure meaningful participation in budget processes, how we can ensure that support for people with learning disabilities supports both their needs and their aspirations, ensuring that resource allocation supports the development of a new human rights bill for Scotland, and the need for partnership working to support all of this to happen. Central to this is ensuring that we listen to the words of people with learning disabilities from across Scotland, like Fiona Dawson, who is a human rights defender from South Ayrshire, who said in her blog for the British Institute of Human Rights, "We need to use human rights to stand up for ourselves and make certain we are heard. We cannot let people with learning disabilities be forgotten about." Thank you again for inviting SCLD to participate, and I look forward to hearing the other panellists' contributions. Thank you.
Thank you. And online again to Callum Hjomzuk.
I'm Hjomzuk. I'm the National Director of the Chartered Institute of Housing Scotland. We are the professional body for those working in the housing sector. We have 2,500 members in Scotland. Most of them work in the renting sector. Most of them work in the social housing sector. And I'm here to represent their views and talk about the work we've done on promoting human rights.
Brilliant. Thanks very much. And thanks to everyone for your written contributions to our call for evidence, which obviously anyone can access via the Scottish Parliament's website. So we're now open up for a bit of a discussion. The aim isn't to have a formal question and answer type session. It's more of a wider discussion. I wonder if I can start with Maggie Chapman to kick that off. Maggie.
Thanks very much, Joe, and good morning, everyone. Thank you for joining us today. I want to start the conversation around questions of process and how we define and describe the process of human rights, include human rights thinking in our budget decisions. Una, you talked about in your opening statements, you said, you know, centering people with lived experiences, centering them in this process is really, really important. And I suppose one of the challenges we have around access, around the time that budgeting processes take, is that inclusion, that participation, which is a key cornerstone of realising rights, seems impossible sometimes. And I was just wondering whether if I can start, Una, with you, what would a transparent and inclusive, accessible process look like for you and the people you work with and support?
Thank you. And that's a question that's really helpful and one that I'm happy to answer. I think for us, and I think in our consultation response, we discussed it as what we're going to term meaningful participation in the budget process. And for SCLD, what that looks like is about accessibility, inclusion, accountability and change. So I think at times we're guilty of asking people with learning disabilities what they think or tell us about their lived experience, but we don't always implement what they say. So I think at times we can see this clearly evidenced in current conversations we're having in Scotland around the Scottish Mental Health Law Review versus the Review of Learning Disability and Autism and the Mental Health Act. So meaningful participation needs to mean that people with learning disabilities are involved in these processes at all levels. So that might mean that people with learning disabilities being invited to take part in committee meetings. And SCLD were pleased to see People First Scotland invited today. A helpful model of participation for the committee to consider is Professor Laura Lundy's model of child participation, which I believe could be developed on. This centres around both the need for voices to be heard and taken account of. Part of participation is also ensuring that organisations that can support capacity building among people with learning disabilities to act as leaders in this area are resourced. So examples of existing work might include Together Scotland's work on the Rights Right Now project and their ongoing work around about rights detectives. We have SCLD, our Future Leaders programme, which has a particular module in it focusing, which might be of interest to this committee, that focuses on charity finances and managing charity finances. Similar approaches could be taken there. We also have our Lived Experience Human Rights Bill, Lived Experience Board, and other positive examples being the Human Rights Consortium's Lived Experience Board. This isn't the only examples happening across Scotland, but certainly a number of ones that we are aware about. I think it's also about accountability. So people with learning disabilities need a way to ensure that their human rights are being realised in practice. So this is where the potential role for a Learning Disability, Autism and Neurodiversity Bill and Commission or Commissioner is needed to defend people with learning disabilities' rights. And I think finally, the most important thing about achieving positive change that will lead to the realisation of rights is that it cannot be participation for participation's sake. Therefore, we need to ask people impacted by these decisions the hard questions so that they can help build solutions. On your point around about transparency, I think that documents like the resource spending review are not accessible. Therefore, it makes it quite challenging for them to be transparent to the people they impact, and the time and resource may be needed to be given to this. And I do take your point regarding time, but I think it's, I guess what I would say is it's time well spent, and it is about calling on those third sector partners, for example, People First and others, who are working with people with learning disabilities to support people with learning disabilities to have a say in these decisions, and about creating processes which are more inclusive. And I think sometimes we can overcomplicate what inclusivity means, but actually being open, transparent, warm, and goes a long way. Thank you.
Thanks very much. You know, that's really helpful, and pointing out some of the strategies and documents that you have both in your written statement and just now are useful for us. I'm wondering, along similar lines, Claire, if I could come to you from your work in SEMVO. We've heard, I think Una rightly points out, just how inaccessible the resource spending review documentation and process has been and can be. And there are obviously things that we need to learn from that. What's your assessment about how we learn from looking backwards and how we actually purely looking forward approach, that kind of revisionist versus actually what we have doesn't work, let's create something new. How do we get, or I suppose what I'm asking is, how do we get the best of both?
I think
from your viewpoint,
I think a lot of what Una said, it really kind of resonates with how we look back, and how it's not just about looking back. We can all look back, but it's about taking what we learn and implementing that and making changes from that. And I think the way to do that is through adopting a human rights-based approach. And for us at SEMVO Scotland, we advocate using the panel principles of participation, accountability, non-discrimination, equality and legality. So these panel principles can be used for policy development, service provision, decision-making processes. They are a tool that's there to be adapted to whatever you need to do. And I think the key point of the panel principles is that we have to, what they allow you to do is address barriers. So when we look backwards and we look at what we've done before, we can see that we are struggling to engage with low-represented groups, marginalised groups, hard-to-reach groups, however we want to word them. But we are consistently not getting those voices heard at the table. And a human rights-based approach allows you to focus on those low-represented groups. And when you reach and design a process that is from the furthest away person that you might try to reach, you inevitably include other people along the way. There are also barriers that specific protected characteristic groups do face when participating. And there's research, there is lots of papers being published about these barriers, but we've identified a couple of really focused ones on the barriers that ethnic minorities face. And I think to look forwards and how to change that is that we have to address those barriers. Yes, we acknowledge them to start off with, but what do I need to do to implement to change that? So, for example, for participation, there is a lack of, in the ethnic minority communities, through our work we've identified there's a lack of trust within public bodies. This might be a result of institutional racism. It's also maybe negative experiences in the past, and there's also a really big fear of how will my information be used and can it be used against me, and that you have to ensure and empower people to know that this is not what we are collecting your information for, this is what we want to hope for the change. The other barrier is apathy, and we talk about a lot, there's a lot of conversation going on about consultation apathy, especially in the third sector. However, I do think that when we're talking about apathy, it's about the apathy of nothing's changed. I give you my opinion, I give you my experience, and I give up my valuable time, and nothing's changed. So I think looking forward, there is obviously you have to learn from your mistakes, but we've done a lot of learning. We've given a lot of evidence. Let's make changes, and using a human rights-based approach can address all protected characteristics, but the important part is that it captures intersectionality because it focuses on the human being.
Thanks very, very much for that, Claire. Jo, did you say Callum?
I think Callum wants to come in.
Did you want to come in on this too?
Yeah, so just adding to the other panellists, I think we've got to start with actually the outcomes that we want to achieve. You know, so if we can set out the kind of the human rights outcomes and actually the standards that we've got, then that will actually inform the decision making. And I recognise that can be a lengthy process, but as we held already, it has to be a lengthy process. It should be a continual process. We're talking about legislating to incorporate human rights. We're talking about we need to do a lot of work to identifying what a minimum quota is just to get us started. Mm. And then we look towards progressive realisation. I think this is an ongoing process for the entire country, for all of us as stakeholders, for service users, for people who lived experience and services. So it is an engaged process, and there's a constant flux. We're constantly considering how we meet that minimum quota and how we go beyond it. You know, I look at the social housing sector, which I'm most familiar with. You know, the social landlords continually engage with tenants every year. Statutory responsibility to engage with tenants around rent. The tenants don't always opt to choose the lowest rent. Tenants and landlords have an engaged process where there's a conversation, understanding about what can actually be invested in, what are the opportunity costs and benefits from actually rent rises or flat rent rates. And that's a partnership. Tenants don't have a veto. I don't want to suggest that. There's a partnership there. And I think that develops a kind of a good outcome. And we see from, you know, the results from the Scottish Housing Regulator that tenants feel genuinely involved in the decision-making process from the landlords. They build time and they build the capacity. And so when you've got that skills and experience and you commit to it as part of your process, you can. I do agree, though, trying to look at the totality of Scottish budget over a couple of months is beyond us. And I think until we set the standards and outcomes that we want to achieve in the outset, I think we're always going to fall short.
Thanks, Callum. That's helpful. I could go on, but I'll let others come in first.
Just to say to all the witnesses that obviously the committee members will be directing questions at particular people, but if you feel you have something to add to that, then just to indicate either, as Callum did, in the chat box if you're online, and otherwise I'll keep looking around. So just kind of indicate to me if you can. I'll move on now to Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Chair, and good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming along. I just want to follow on from what, Claire, you've just answered there for Maggie in relation to marginalised groups. I've sat on many round tables with many BAME communities and spoke to them about whether it's to do with any policies, decision-making, that they always feel that they're not included. Now, you did mention earlier on quite a few, I think it was 600, did you mention, or was it groups that you go out to and you're talking to? Somehow, information is not reaching out to those people right on the ground. And I understand what you've said, that there is a trust element. Absolutely, I come from one of those communities. It's about, why do you want to use our information? And if you're going to use it, is something going to change? Now, that is, yes, I'm fully aware, that is something that they are all questioning. Do you think maybe we should be looking at changing our tactics a little bit in relation to, rather than just using those groups, that we move out to more wider community groups and maybe in more religious settings that looking at, because that's where a lot of belief is. For example, I can tell you I come from, you know, my family come from, you know, the Sikh background, and if you went into the Gurdwara and you spoke about something, or even if you spoke about, you know, you had a group there downstairs, not in where actually the main congregation is, but comes down and you spoke about this information, or you gave some kind of workshops out, because every single religious place has schools, whether it's to do with a mosque or Gurdwara or Jewish, or anything, they have basically schools. Do you think there's an element there that we can maybe look at, or have you looked at that, to give more information to those people so that they can actually be more involved in decision making?
Yeah, I think a change is needed, because we're not capturing those voices that need to be heard. I think we'd always ask for a strategic approach to this. So starting at the beginning, not at the end. So starting, let's think about the lowest, low represented group, or the groups that I'm not hearing for. And we know that, and we know who those people are. If you plan, say, for example, an engagement event focusing on that target audience, there's certain things by using the panel principles that will facilitate you getting there on the way to being meaningfully participative. So, for example, for me, meaningful participation, it means about, it's not just about, I've given you the information, now it's your job to come to me and tell me what you think. If you're going to break down the barriers that I talked about before, and that you recognised as well, is that you have to go into communities and you have to go into places. It's not come to me and I'll tell you. Go into communities, have the information available in accessible documents, but also having different languages available. We live in a really diverse Scotland just now, and most things are still printed off in English, and then we have easy read English. So I think it's about going into communities, going into religious settings are a really good example. We've done a lot of work with the vaccine inclusion research team, where we have went into mosques to promote and share flyers about vaccines. And it's about talking to religious leaders as well, because that's where your that's where trust is. And it's about getting them on board as well to share your message, not about, as you said, going into the main congregation as such in that hall, but these are places that have schools where children are in. And I think it's a underutilised avenue to engage with people. We've also just ran 6 engagement events around the hate crime strategy, and that was about going into mosques, going into community centres from Inverness to Falkirk, and the information is all there. There's no, once you go in and people see your face, you tell them why you're here, why you're there, you empower them to know the importance of their decision. You tell them that when we have finished analysing all your information, I'm going to come back to you and tell you what outcome this has been, whether it been a policy change or a direct impact. And it's just about sharing that feedback loop. And then they're more encouraged to participate in future things as well.
No, thank you, Claire. And I think what you've just touched on there, that's very important, is going back to them to say that their information, yeah, you know, was valuable. And I think that's when they'll feel to get open up again. So, yeah, certainly I welcome the fact that you're saying a lot of change is needed. And vaccine showed us, because I know I've seen it in Gurdwara's mosques, and it was brilliant how we rolled that out and looked at that. But I think we should certainly learn from something like that.
And Sarah would like to come in.
I just wanted to add a point around the accessibility of information. And as was mentioned earlier, documents like the resource spending review being so dense and difficult to make sense of. But also each year, the annual budget, if you look at it, it will be hard. It's hard for people to think, what difference is this making to my everyday life? When in fact, it's making loads of difference to their everyday life. So a starting another kind of early point in participation is making the information a lot more accessible. And We'd recommend the publication of a citizen's budget each year as a way of bringing the information in the budget to explain what it's meaning for people's lives, and also to start people feeling a connection to the budget process itself as well, so that it isn't just this distant thing that's discussed and there's massive documents about, because only very highly engaged people are going to choose to engage in those kind of documents.
Yeah, Claire, that was really valid, plain English.
Yeah, just before we go to Alan, who's wanting to come in there, what would the citizens' budget look like, and is there any examples of that being used anywhere? No, not necessarily at a national government, but any other kind of...
In terms of the examples, I'm going to need to come back to you after this of where a kind of a good example is. But it would be breaking down information say, in portfolio areas and looking at what that means at a more kind of individual household or community right. level, so that you can see that there's a decision for however many millions going in education. Well, what does that mean for the number of school places and the number of the access at community level, and what does that mean for what my household should be able to access, as well as what individuals yes. should be able to access. So, and it would also, you know, I'll look for some good examples, yeah. but such like bringing some visuals to it as well. So, and I think SPICE publications in recent. Previous budget years, you know, there's definitely a move and an effort to get the information better broken down so that it can make more sense to people, but really bringing it to that kind of level.
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks. Alan?
Yeah, I just wanted to make sort of quite a brief point building on what a lot of people have said about going out to communities to engage with people and about inclusive communications, and that, you know, the budget is the biggest thing the Scottish Parliament does every year. It's completely fundamental. And if we're viewing the budget as sort of an investment in the people of Scotland should themselves be invested in the budget. So I think that there isn't a much better use of resources at budget time than, you know, putting some of that resource to making sure that we're able to actually go out to those communities. So making sure that, you know, people aren't just being asked about their views but actually being supported, so they've got those, you know, inclusive communications, so where you're providing things in braille format and easy read so it can access in different communities. Talked about community languages as well, and also, you know, people are sort of getting that resource, the resources there, so that they know that that what they're be feeding in is able to sort of influence results, and they're seeing what the final outcome of those is.
Yeah, brilliant. Thanks. Karen.
Thank you. And good morning to everybody. It is still morning, isn't it? Yeah. It's just been fascinating to hear how this should work and could work and the process of it. I'd really like to ask you, Sarah, a question. I'm really interested in how this works for women in particular, and, you know, what type of outcomes you're looking for. I was just, you know, thinking there back to, we still have situations where women are mostly still have the burden of care placed upon them. So if we have a woman that stays at home raising children for most of her life and doesn't even reach the entitlement for a state pension, for example, I mean, what are some of the examples that, you know, that we could do, that things that could help those kind of situations? I mean, are those the type of things we're looking at, those kind of inequalities? And also, if we're looking to have a health and wellbeing economy here in Scotland, what does that look like, actually, from that, you know, human rights-based approach, but specifically for women?
Quite big questions. You'll have seen in our evidence that we call for the human rights-based approach to budgeting, but continuing to have a gender budgeting lens within that, because it's really important that human rights and equalities are working together. Obviously, I don't need to tell this committee that, but that the analysis is there. So, as others have explained, kind of taking the approach, and as Callum was saying, like looking at the outcomes from the start, from a human rights-based perspective, but then throughout the approach, ensuring you're bringing in the equalities analysis to look at the differences that, well, from our perspective, particularly the differences that women and men are facing, but also all the intersectional differences. So women face a variety of different experiences, and by doing that, for us, the care economy would be a huge part of it. As you mentioned, women are much more likely to spend to be unpaid carers, do a significant amount more of unpaid work in the economy. And so a human rights-based approach that takes equalities lenses within it would be looking at how we can invest more into the care economy so that it's a choice for women, whether they're caring or not, that there's access to childcare if they want it from when maternity pay stops, so that people have that choice of whether they work or they care for children. And we would also be calling that there was that policies for employment meant that care could be shared more equitably between women and men, but that's beyond the budget process. But those sorts of choices, that sort of investment would mean that as women get to retirement age, there wouldn't be the greater chance of them being in poverty that there is now. So women are more likely to be in poverty in retirement because of the factors you mentioned in the question. So the investment in care is a really crucial element. And through the human rights-based approach with the Equalities lens into it, we believe that sort of the need to invest in that sector would be kind of highlighted, and that's where kind of the investment could focus.
Yeah, I just coming back in there, Kavina, I was just thinking, and so we're looking at a preventative kind of system as well. So it's not just mitigating perhaps what might happen to women, but even as early intervention as young women and girls as well, and coming through school and giving them opportunities and options and making them aware of that choice. And perhaps there's opportunity to be investing in that, you think?
Certainly. And I think from our point of view, if you have the information and the analysis and the participation of women of different ages, that can all feed into the process to look at where the investment is needed and where preventative spend can go as well. And I know it can sound like a lot of different things being heaped on the budget process, yeah. Human rights budgeting, gender budgeting, wellbeing, yeah. Economy. But we believe and these can all work together, and they're not all separate processes, but they can work together and bring the analysis in together so that we can work for an economy that is achieving its best, and that there can be this kind of wellbeing, caring economy through that process.
That's helpful, thank you.
And Sarah, sorry.
Hi, I'm Susan from the Scottish Women's Convention. We totally agree with what Sarah's saying with regards to the Scottish Government and attempting to do the human rights. It's really important for women, mm-hmm. especially because women are marginalised. When you look at the inequalities that women face day in, day out, you can see that there is major impact. Any fiscal decision will have a major impact on a woman. Mm-hmm. So when we look at it, the large focus that the Scottish Government have been doing has been reducing child poverty, which is commendable. But unless we get the human rights with regards to budgeting right for women, mm-hmm. we're always going to have child poverty, so we have to look at it in that way. We have to incorporate it all. Mm-hmm. I think if we look at protected characteristics, if we need to look at what we, like Callum had said, we need to look at what we want Scotland to be, human rights. Do we want our women to feel that they are less than the men in our country? Mm-hmm. No, so we need to change that. We need to think about the economic policies that we're getting. The budget at the moment is solely focused, we would say, on entrepreneurship rather than care. And that has a detrimental effect for women because women do the majority of care and the social care and health for their families. And they seem to feel forgotten. When we're speaking to women, they say that a lot of money's going into STEM and finance, but actually the majority of work that's done by women is in the health and social care partnerships, and Alan would probably testament that with lived experience from women from the Alliance as well. But women dominate these sectors, which are the lowest paid, which are obviously the lowest valued, because when we look at our budgetary process, we can see that we don't value health and care as much as what we do entrepreneurship, STEM and finance. And I think that's something we have to look at going forward. With regards to budgetary processes, if we want to get this right, we need to start building an infrastructure so that no matter how much money comes into our budget, we've got a way of putting that out towards everyone in our society so that they can have their say in it. But we would also recommend the gender budgeting strategy be adopted alongside participatory methods to consider the lived experience of both men and women, and making the current inequalities more visible. So for women, I've got an example of one woman and what she said. She said so many people are working in the women are caring in the service sector. They get low paid compared with those working in IT or STEM, but so much responsibility goes into caring for someone. Why is that not valued? Mm. Another one said, for me, the issue is that there is a total lack of economic value typically demonstrated towards the majority of female professions. When I worked in nurseries early years, I had to sit through exams, I had to go through lots of qualifications, and the pay was dismal. That is not at all comparative to other skilled professions, which also require qualifications, so we have to look at it from that point of view as well. And I think the more that we go out to communities, they are having these conversations. If you go to a mothers and toddler group, they're having conversations mm-hmm. about how this budget is impacting their lives. We are not hearing it because we don't want to hear it. I think when we say seldom heard or hard to reach, they're not. They're there having these conversations. What the problem is, we seldom listen. And I think that has to change. If we really want to have a human rights budget and approach and get it right for people in Scotland, we need to do the listening and we need to have accountability for that.
Absolutely. Thank you for that. I think that really resonates with the women's voices. To a lot of people coming across as white noise a lot of the time. And I think, yeah, we really need to find out how we're going to hone in and listen to that. And it's interesting because the feedback we had in a session earlier was, you know, this is reaches further than, you know, our fiscal, you know, policy, because earlier we were talking about maybe a lack of labour, so labour shortage. You're also talking about the nature of the job. Women are more likely to do that because it is more flexible with the care that they'd be doing in their own personal lives. So it's the nature of the job as well, and perhaps maybe, yeah, you know, looking at different employment, career progression, that kind of
there
thing.
There definitely has to be more
Vast, isn't it?
Yeah. There has to be more flexibility. If you look at the maternity policies, they're all geared towards women. Why are we not encouraging men to take up that job? Why are we not encouraging the same maternity benefits for men? The reason is because men are in higher paid jobs. If you look at the gender pay gap, it means there's more of a drop in that income for that household, and that's why that happens. So we have to look at it in a bigger picture to understand why we have women in lower paid jobs that are taking part-time work that are not fulfilling their potential to get their full pension, and it's because we do not give them the social and equal opportunities that they deserve. Yeah.
Thank you.
Callum would like to come in briefly there.
Yeah, just to add very briefly, I absolutely agree with what the previous panellists have said. I think there's a real challenge, we know, just building capacity and skills for kind of human rights budget and gender budgeting across Scotland. I think we can almost look at some of the examples of EQIAs that we see in our public services. They're done. We go through a process going through an EQIA, but a lot of them don't really unpack some of the complexity around kind of equalities and actually address the issues. If we're serious about this, I think Alan touched upon it earlier, we need to build capacity and skills amongst kind of leaders in the Scottish Government across our public services to actually work with people, to work with communities, where people live, experience services, understand how they improved. I could think of an example in Fife, where Fife Council had an assessment in their domestic abuse services, and they were found to be wanting at that point. They engaged in a kind of community, kind of participatory process. They worked for 2 years with victims, survivors of domestic abuse, really assess what was wrong with what Fife was doing. And actually, from that, they set out the kind of the outcomes and standards they want and rechange the process. So it can work. It just takes that time, investment and skill, and that builds ultimately that leadership.
OK, thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for everybody's contribution so far and for what you've given us in advance as well. They were really, really helpful, as always, responses. I want to focus a bit on... Well, first of all, I have a question about the participation that we've just discussed. And I guess it's based on what we've heard about some of the barriers. How would you characterise the way in which you've been involved in the budget to date and the resource spending review? And specifically, maybe if Susan and Alan and Una and Claire could answer that briefly. I know that's a lot of answers, but like if you could be really brief. I'm just trying to get a sense of. How engaged have you guys been in the budget process, or how open has it been to you?
Yep.
We were involved in the economic transformation talks with the Finance Minister, Kate Forbes, and we did discuss all the issues with regards to gender budget and participatory budgeting and things like that. But at the end of it, most of the women's organisations that were involved in that had asked if we could look at that in more depth, and were told no, because the budget had to be done. And we just felt as if what we were saying for the people that we were advocating for wasn't fully taken forward. And I appreciate that there's time restraints and stuff to get stuff done, but if we really value what these people are saying to us, to then say to the finance department that are dealing with the budget, then we really need to look at how we are held accountable for that. We are given those instructions across about what women are telling us, and we came out that meeting feeling as if we weren't listened to.
Thank you. Alan?
Yeah, so the Alliance, I don't think we've been involved as sort of we've been directly approached, but instead we've been responding to sort of the public facing side of things. So we responded to the resource spending reviews, sort of the consultation on the framework for that, responded to, you know, various consultations and calls for views on budgets and, you know, pre-budget scrutiny over the years. I think perhaps a point that I was going to touch on later, though, is that I think budget processes are relatively open if you are a third sector organisation, if you're a business, if you're a campaigning group, if you're a political party, but they're not necessarily very open if you are an individual with lived experience. Now, a lot of our organisations, you know, we're at the Alliance, and we are representative of people with lived experience, but it's not entirely the same thing having people who are representatives of involved in the budget process than having the people who have that lived experience themselves. So it's perhaps a process that's been open for organisations, but less so for individuals.
Thank you. Una, would you like to?
Hi there.
Thank you.
Aside from, as Alan said, submissions to some calls for views around about budgets, we haven't had the opportunity to maybe be involved as much as we would have liked, or to support people with learning disabilities to be involved. But that is, you know, something that we would be happy to be involved in as much as possible in the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Like Una and Alan, we've not been involved directly with the budget process so far. We have responded to consultations just like this one. Much like what Alan had said before, I think the budget process needs to ensure that it can incorporate and use data collected from the participation. So right now it seems as if we're only gathering quantitative data, because we like numbers and budgets go hand in hand, but we also need to think about qualitative data, because numbers don't reflect lived experience and they certainly don't capture intersectionality. Mm-hmm. And I think that's integral to how we engage people in the budget process. Yeah. I also think we have to recognise that budgets can come with a lot of jargon that everyday people don't understand. And that was probably doing a disservice to a lot of people, but I certainly struggled with some of the jargon. But I think it kind of falls into that meaningful participation, and that you have to do capacity building with, if you're asking people to participate, make sure they know what they're talking about. Don't just ask them to come into a room and say, what do you think about X, Y, and Z? And they don't know what X, Y, and Z is and what impact that has on their life. So going out and saying, this is what a budget is, this is how it impacts your life. It's much like a citizen's budget, but it's about, but also you have to be able to support specific communities to do that. So I think the budget process has to, for people to engage in it more, and from what seems to come from this response, is that we want people's lived experience and we want this information, but our process doesn't really allow us to commute it or then action it afterwards.
Thank you. That's really helpful. And the reason I was asking it is because we heard earlier on about the importance of transparency. Obviously, we've already discussed that. I just want to try and get a feel for where we're at, so that we can understand as a committee what the kind of scale of the challenge is. In the same vein then, my next question, if that's all right, convener, is around minimum core rights and progressive realisation, and what do we need to measure? So those are big questions. We heard a lot this morning about that. And I know in your evidence, Gillian from Audit Scotland, that there's a gap between the rights that the government encourage or say that people have or want people to have and the reality of that. In your evidence, Susan, you say that women have been overlooked. And I know that evidence from others, including SLD and your letter, of course, to the British Institute of Human Rights in 2016, have really highlighted some of the problems we've got. So what do we need to... You can look at budget lines, right? That, like, for example, in social care, and we can see that there might be more money going into that, or there might be more money going into social security. But actually, we heard this morning from people with learning disabilities who aren't even able to choose who they live with. So you could argue that the budget going up represents progressive realisation, but the lived reality kind of really doesn't even represent much of a minimum core, actually, I would say. So how could we, what do we need to measure, and what kind of framework could we use to help us get to a point where we can ask questions about develop a minimum core and then ask sensible questions about the budget? And I guess I'll just throw that open to anyone who feels they want to give it a go.
To come in? Sorry, we'll go to Gillian first. You're right, you pointed it to Gillian, and then we'll go to Una.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think, again, there's a lot in that, but...
No,
I think because it's not a simple area, is it? So it is complex, and there's lots of elements to it. And I think a lot of the things that have come up already, play into that. And I think it definitely comes back to... outcomes and being really clear at the beginning about what it is you're trying to, what outcomes you're trying to reach, and how do you do that? How do you get there? But then, how does the budget and the funding relate to that? Because we often find across various reports that additional investments going in, but we don't really know what we're getting for that additional money. Mm-hmm. Because it isn't linked clearly to outcomes, or the measures that are there are not measuring outcomes. A lot of it's outputs rather than the outcomes. So there's, and around the data, even when there is data, there's still a lot of data gaps as well. And we put a lot in our, because I think it's something that comes up in practically every Audit Scotland report, yeah, is about data gaps. So there's quite a lot in our written submission there around that, and examples across lots of different reports. But an area that we've talked about this morning, which I think is a really important area at the moment and will be in the future, obviously, is social care, which published a report on earlier this year. And huge gaps, compared to health data, there's huge gaps within social care, so it's really difficult to measure what's going on for different groups of people over time. We can't really tell what unmet need is, and we know that eligibility criteria has been tightening because of tightening budgets. But it's all collected locally, but it's not pulled together nationally. So it's really difficult to know even, there's measures around current demand, as in the services that are delivered, but that's not the true demand because we can't quantify unmet need because it's not collected properly. Mm-hmm. So we don't really know. Obviously, there's a lot of additional investment being promised to go into that, but we don't really know, where is that going to be targeted to? I know there's still a lot of work to be done around the National Care Service. But what is that actually trying to achieve? We've talked about preventative measures. And again, it's something that we've talked about quite a lot in our health and social care reports, particularly is needing to move towards a more preventative approach. And it's just thinking about investing differently in different types of services. And it's having that longer term outlook, and what does that, what's it you're trying to aim for in 10, 20 years time? That's more difficult, obviously, to measure and think about and plan. But if you're looking at that, then the things that you need to get to there will fall into place. But at the moment, we can't, the information isn't there to measure that.
Thank you.
So, Pam, just so as you know, we've got Una, Claire and Alan all wanting to come
okay.
in. So
thank you.
Una first, I think.
Thank you. So I think for SCLD, what's key to the question you've asked is the point that the Scottish Human Rights Commission made in their report on human rights budgeting, which is that human rights budgeting should make sure that support services are acceptable to all and not one size fits all. So I think to do that, what we need to do is to look at where people's rights are most at risk in Scotland and allocate resources based on that. And I would point to the work done around about the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child in Corporation Scotland Bill and the Children's Scheme, where we had a children's scheme that said that we had to identify and address any situation where a child's rights are at risk or significant risk of not being fulfilled. And what that then does is means that you can allocate budgets more appropriately based on those who are most at risk of not having their rights realised and who are not having that minimum core of rights realisation in Scotland, and then how you work towards more progressive realisation as time moves on. So, and I think in Scotland at the moment, we're seeing a real struggle with that in regard to learning disability. So I think it was the Fraser Valander Institute report on Scotland's adult social care system for people with learning disabilities that said that following the financial crisis, the means and ambitions set out in the Scottish Government strategy, the Keys to Life, had very little chance of actually being realised. So we've seen the closing of long-stay hospitals, but despite that, existing systems, even self-directed support, at times have been found to make it hard for people with learning disabilities to access the support they need. And meanwhile, a lack of support for transitions in housing means that people with learning disabilities are kind of left out from accessing the support they need. And this was all compounded by the COVID-19 pandemic and reduced levels of support. What this is leading to is the potential of a reinstitutionalisation of people with learning disabilities in Scotland. So, for example, the Coming Home report stated that 705 people with learning disabilities were living in out-of-area placements. 45% of those people had been there for more than 10 years. 109 had not chosen their placement and were identified as priority to return. And there were also 79 people placed outside of Scotland. And the main reasons detailed for this by health and social care partnerships were a lack of funding, service provision and or suitable accommodation. So it's about how we can actually put resources in place to address these significant issues. And I would just go on to say that to do that, it's really critical that we have appropriate disability disaggregated data in Scotland. And this has been an issue that we have seen ongoing for a number of years. And is despite the Article 31 of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Persons with Disabilities, that states that governments should collect appropriate information, including statistical and research data, to enable them to formulate and implement policies to give effect to the present convention. And that includes data disaggregation. And this is also despite the United Nations Committee on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities addressing the issue around about a lack of statistical data in the UK in relation to data disaggregation on disability, including learning disability. We've seen the negative impact that a lack of data and disaggregated data has had, for example, during the COVID-19 pandemic, where there was an unacceptable delay in understanding how the crisis affected people with learning disabilities. The death rate between January and August 2020 was not published until February 2021, and it was based on census data captured more than 10 years ago. So what a lack of disability data, disaggregated data, does for people with learning disabilities in Scotland is that it makes them invisible in legislation, policy and decision making. And this invisibility is felt by people with learning disabilities in Scotland, who often tell us they feel that they are at the bottom of the pile. The most stark examples of this include Margaret Fleming, who was missing, I think it was up to 18 years before anybody noticed. We need budget decisions that are truly rights respecting, that are based on the evidence and data collection that is better and more looking towards what we don't know rather than just collecting what we do know and what is currently easy to get. Thank you.
So I think Claire.
Yeah, it was just to pick up on really from what Una and Gillian have said. Minimum core standards are obviously a pillar in human rights law. There are international standards in relation to minimum core of housing, budgets. They are available, but I think what we have to do and what We've been trying to work on a member of the leadership panel for the Scottish National Action Plan for Human Rights, and it's about capacity building and what does a minimum core of, for example, a right to housing look like for the people in Scotland. But once you have that, how do the people in charge, so the duty bearers and in the budget process, the people making the budget decisions, how are we making sure that they're aware of what the minimum core are? Because a lot of the times it's not something that's within their everyday job remit. Mm-hmm. And therefore, when decisions are being made, they're not being made with this in mind. I think as well, I strongly agree with Una about the problem with data. We have, there is a huge issue across Scotland and specifically amongst public bodies on the collection of data and the high non-disclosure rates. And even when you do have good non-disclosure rates, the way that it's disaggregated is not consistent. But it also doesn't, it can't tell you much, so we can't use it the way that we want to. And to have outcomes and how do we track change and things, we have, our outcomes should be dependent on our benchmark of data. And if our benchmark data isn't accurate, which it isn't just now, then how can we really make rights real for people, and especially for people whose rights are most at risk? So through our work in the Race for Human Rights programme, we talk a lot about data and the disaggregation of data, and I think there are lots of barriers to participating in the data process. I've talked about them before, about trust and apathy. But as we've heard today, a human rights-based approach to data collection, of which we've developed a guidance document on that I'm happy to share with, is that you prioritise the low-represented groups and you make sure they're your target audience as such. And I think the other part that we have to be aware of is for our outcomes and how we track things is we have to underpin them with human rights specifically, so we can use human rights as a golden thread to start from a budget point of view, from generation to allocation to spending and its impact. And we can trace, is that your right to social security that's respecting, or your right to an adequate standard of living? And to be able to do that, you have to have a consistent approach. So data collection forms, we've seen over the last year or so, like an array of different types of data collection forms when it's relating to equality. But the problem is it doesn't set any kind of benchmark for our demographic. So for some local authorities, we've seen data within the ethnicity bracket saying white British, non-white British, other. So you're not asking the right questions to begin with. And it's across, it's not specific in one area and it's not specific to local authorities. The different directorates at the Scottish Government don't have a consistent view. So if you're not asking the same questions, you can't capture the right picture.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Alan?
Yes, just sort of back to what I'm asking about the minimum core side of things. And I think the Alliance made that point in our response that we would generally sort of recognise that investment in social security and health and social care is sort of representative of our commitment to human rights, but that there isn't necessarily the same degree of clarity that, you know, that it is actually making impact. So I think, I can't remember exactly what document it was, but one of the documents did have a list where it gave, you know, policies that, the budget policies that could be pursued and what specific rights those policies were sort of aiming to support. So for example, the right to the highest attainable standard of health, rights to social security. And I thought that was a useful starting point. But I think what was clear in some of the responses other organisations put in is that, and in the SPICE briefing, is that minimum core perhaps hasn't yet been fully defined, as Pam was saying, when you know, someone not being able to have the choice of who they lived with. If we're talking about rights like the right to independent living, which is in the UNCRPD, how do you have a right to independent living if you can't even choose who you live with? So I think it would be useful to have that definition for what does the minimum core specifically look like, perhaps in a Scottish context, and then in sort of budget processes, laying out not just what rights each of the budget lines are intended to help realise, but how they will do so and how they will measure that. So again, just sort of coming to Pam's point, because I think it's useful that if we're going to say that a particular investment is to support the right to independent living, then that means that people have to be able to choose who they live with. It means that people have to have support to be able to live, like, you know, normal lives and go out, you know, if they want to, you know, do whatever they want, you know, pursue leisure, pursue education, pursue a career and so on. So making sure that there are specific measures, we're not just saying this will support this right, but it will support this right by achieving these particular aims.
Okay, thank you. And Rachel?
Yes, so it's just to expand on the questions regarding data. Claire, I'm interested in what you were saying there. I just wonder what existing mechanisms there are in place for non-governmental bodies and civil society to play their part in, you know, gathering that data and shaping policy.
There are lots of examples of what people do to gather data. So I think a lot of us here from organisations, we do have a lot of networks and we try and gather that data. But it's about, when we're gathering it, a lot of the time it's about asking, we try to make sure that when we're asking for people's opinions on things, people's views, people's experiences, is that we're valuing their time. Now there's a lot of work being done by the Commission, the Scottish Human Rights Commission, about valuing voluntary participants, because that's about paying people for their time. So yes, they shouldn't be out of pocket, firstly, for transport purposes or whatever, but also if you're really going to have a system where it values lived experience, you have to make it real for people. We use, through our consultancy support with, it's offered to public sector and third sector organisations, we've developed a document around a human rights-based approach to data collection, and we use the panel principles, and what it allows you to do is it allows you to design your process and your disaggregation and what you do with it and how you share with it afterwards to address the barriers that I talked about before around trust and apathy. But it's about being all-inclusive, and it's about having, it will ask you to do in your accountability section, it might ask you to do equality human rights impact assessment, and the key part of including human rights in an equality impact assessment is because it takes in the whole picture of that human being. It takes in their protected characteristics, of course, it takes in their social and economic background, it will take in even their the area where they live, whether it be rural or in the city, and it takes it in a way that you can design a process that is accessible to all. The other good thing about a human rights-based approach to data collection is the part that a lot of people start with is the legality section. So in my last response, I'd said about everything should be underpinned by human rights, from indicators to outcomes. We have to know what we're measuring and track it through this, I call it the golden thread, but however you want to call it. But when you go through the legality process, especially with data collection, you have to address some of the barriers. So we know that we have laws to protect our privacy, our GDPR. We know we ask for data because of the Equality Act and lots of other legislations. But let's talk about our rights in particular, and I'll ask you to make sure that, so okay, I've got my right to private and family life, but I want to know information about a certain person's private and family life, so I'm interfering with their right. Okay, if I do that, I have to make sure that it's pursuant of a legitimate aim, and I have to make sure it's proportionate. So my legitimate aim is that it might be I want to have positive action measures to make my workforce more diverse. That could be your legitimate aim. And your proportionality could be I'm going to have targeted recruitment, but you need, what you do is you underpin everything by human rights, and then you can track the outcomes, and it creates a whole bigger, a more focused system, and it's easier to track what's going on. Because I think a lot of the time within third sector, we've got information, but it's like, who wants to know this information? Because, and sometimes we get asked to give the same information time and time and time again, that's a part of the human rights based process as well, as about empowerment and sharing the feedback, like I talked about earlier on.
Yeah, and do you have any interaction with the Scottish Government's Equality Data Improvement Programme, which is up and running right now?
No.
Okay, that's interesting. Gillian, we heard in the previous session that gaining more data would help support disabled people to gain employment opportunities, housing, improve their health outcomes. I mean, I think everyone in the room understands that. I just wondered how Audit Scotland were monitoring the progress of the local authorities' involvement in that and their understanding of gathering and capturing data to ensure that those services are delivered with dignity. One example I gave this morning was, you know, the right to education for disabled people, and understanding that perhaps there isn't the public transport or there are geographical issues with reaching that education. So somebody has to travel, you know, 50 miles per day, whereas the family can't support that. So it's very difficult. And also the support surrounding that individual's needs as well. So I just wondered if you can give us an overview of where you are with Audit Scotland's progress.
Yeah, perhaps we would do a kind of annual overview every year on local government performance. And last year we did pick up around data gaps, and it wasn't necessarily exactly what you're referring to there, but I guess it was around the pandemic and recovery and how councils were looking at that and how it impacted different groups and if it was equal or, you know, who'd been more adversely affected. And obviously we're aware that some groups are more adversely affected than others, and particularly those that were already vulnerable or within certain characteristics. And we found that councils were really struggling around that, about collecting data. I think it's just similar to what Claire sort of alluded to, that it's not done consistently. So I think there may be intelligence within individual councils, or it might be just within certain departments, but it's actually joining that up and then making it meaningful to measure these kind of things or know what kind of improvements need to be done by using it properly or being able to link the data together is where it struggles. And I think quite often we're seeing in sort of different areas, topic areas or sectors, that sometimes there is local data, but then it's not joined up nationally, so you don't get that overall picture. And then how does that feed into the national, you know, the overall budget?
Yeah, so I think you're absolutely right. I was hearing that some local authorities collect data on the waiting times for services for people with autism spectrum. And, you know, if the local authorities are not able to support an individual who is either waiting or has been diagnosed, that's very difficult. So I'm just making this, I'm being clear, aren't I? I've understood that nationally the picture is not always being done in a sort of a way that the local authorities can benefit, and not everybody is doing everything that they should perhaps do, even if it's on a statutory footing. Would that be fair?
Yeah.
Okay. I just wanted to ask Una, talking about the statutory requirements for data gathering, I mean, you've used examples of individuals, say disabled people who are stuck in hospital for many years and not able to be discharged. But how can the current statutory requirements for data gathering be improved to meet this inclusion and accessibility?
Thank you. That's a really important question. And I think for us, and while we completely understand the basis of the language around about disabled people and the social model of disability, for us there has been a slight issue in terms of the scope in which the Equality Act has used that, and actually how, therefore, there has been data collection around about, you know, we may get the figures on disabled people as a whole population, and while that's totally appropriate and helpful, it's there. We need to look actually within that to people who have learning disabilities, and that's what we mean when we talk about data disaggregation, to get that level of data. So, for example, we know that disabled people as a whole face particular issues in relation to employment, but I think the most recent figures in relation to people with learning disabilities was around 4.1%, which is significantly lower than the disabled people as a whole population. So it's that bit around about acknowledging that certain groups within certain protected characteristics face kind of, it's about facing kind of multiple inequalities as an already a group that already faces unequal treatment and faces barriers. So it's actually about acknowledging that, saying we appreciate and understand there are groups of people whose present their rights are maybe most at risk, and asking that data be collected around those individual groups. Thank you.
And just one last point, just on gathering Equalities data, Sarah. The First Minister's Women and Girls Advisory Council wants intersectional budgeting, gender budgeting analysis integrated into the Scottish budget, and for that to be put on a statutory footing. I'm not sure if your organisation's involved in that at all. And also, I noted that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation and the Fraser Islander have said there's long-term concerns about or shortcomings when looking at gathering equalities data. Again, the same question to you as I gave to Una. What improvements can be made in terms of that data gathering? Is it just about engaging people, as Claire's spoken about as well?
And just in terms of the National Advisory Council, we support the recommendation they have, probably not surprisingly, to put gender budgeting on a statutory footing and to look at how to do that within maybe something like the public sector equality duty. In terms of what improvements can be made in terms of data on a, that's collected on a statutory footing, there's a few different reviews underway by government just now in terms of the equality data consultation that was just conducted, the public sector equality review, and there's also the mainstreaming strategy that's been underway as well. And we think it's important that these come together so that they're all working. I'm sure that there is efforts to make sure they're all working to ensure that we get the best possible data and that there's the clearest advice as well, particularly for across all public bodies, the clearest advice about the type of data to be collecting and to bring that consistency that others have mentioned. What's really important as well is that the data can be used intersectionally, and that is another kind of gap area where in areas where there is data, it's often then not used in an intersectional way, so we can't do the kind of step back of what's the experience for disabled women or what's the experience for black women. And so it's the need to bring in that analysis once you've got the data too. So it just... I agree with all the points that have been made about the need to improve data quality and consistency, but there's also a crucial element, once we've got there, that needs to start now, about improving the analysis that goes into when that data is used. And Callum mentioned earlier about equality impact assessments, and I think it's quite widely viewed about that the quality of them is very varying and often on the poorer side. And Equalities Budget Advisory Group made recommendations last year about how the work could be done to improve the consistency on how data is used and to improve kind of in terms of building capacity so that there's better use of data once we have it as well.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. And Fulton.
Thanks, Convener, and good afternoon now to all the panel. And, thanks for all your contributions so far. I wanted to ask about a couple of areas, and it's about this area of, you know, we've talked about, and I know some witnesses have referred to, where the Scottish Government have maybe got a human rights goal or policy, but it's not what people are finding that are happening on the ground. So I'm wondering if maybe some of the panel could talk about how this committee and how the government as a whole could perhaps, or the parliament as a whole could perhaps, you know, meet some of these challenges. And I guess that links into the second part of my question, which is how able are local councils able to play their role in meeting human rights aspirations set out by the Scottish Government? And it might be quite easy for, you know, some people come back and say, well, that's just about funding local. A government isn't funded enough, or the local government is funded enough, but I wouldn't want the argument to be about there. It's about how do the local governments decide with the funding they've got, which services are cut. And if colleagues don't mind, because they have heard, I'll give an example that I'm dealing with locally just now, which I think makes this point very clearly. I've got a mobility hub in my constituency, which is due to close. It was given very short notice that the charity that runs it is going to close it. Just at the end of this week, we are fighting that. But the mobility hub serves a large number of people in the local area and allows them with physical disabilities, mainly, but also with learning disabilities, to access town centre, health care appointments, etc., etc. And I've been round houses trying to, you know, get somebody to stand up and say, you know, who can save this service? But everybody, whether it's the Scottish Government, the local council, the health board, or the charity organisation just seem to pass it on to somebody else. And there's a real risk that by doing that, nobody wants a service to close. Everybody thinks it's a good service, everybody thinks disabled people need it. But by this whole system that we've got, a service, is there a real risk of closing this week? I also should say that I've noted, Susan, and something that you said that sprung to mind is the amount of women that use this service is disproportionately high. And also even the women who have come to ask for it to be saved are actually carers for the men who use it. So a real impact on women as well. So I wanted to make that point. So that's just an example. I do believe that I don't expect the panel to reflect exactly on my constituency example. I'm dealing with that, and I know that members will have similar examples around the country. But I think it does make the point that I'm trying to get here is that we do have human rights policies and ideas and goals in this Parliament that we all share as parliamentarians across parties. And sometimes, you know, there's things that happen that the general public just don't understand how this can be allowed to happen. If the panel get any advice on what the committee can do and the Parliament can do to try and, you know, have a better overview of where this budget decisions around these human rights issues are taking place. I see Susan wanting to come in.
I would just say it goes to diversity. Who's on the local councils? We were just in Barra recently talking to women about what's happening with their health and social care. They no longer have a doctor because the doctor's quit because of the way the health board's being run. But the diversity on that board is mostly white men, and they've not got the diversity to think about the protected characteristics of others because there's no lived experience of that. So you need to have participatory people on these boards and your local councils that are able to stand up for the decisions that are being made and put that in a human rights like portfolio. Who is this going to affect? How is it going to affect them? Is this what you're wanting to achieve? It doesn't always come down to money. I think with the budgets, like we all know, we're all being stretched, and I know that whatever's happening down south of the border is having a major impact here. But it comes down to empathy and compassion for your fellow person. Like, we're all human beings. If you're looking at human rights as a human rights approach, that's the way we should be seeing everybody. We should be having people with lived experience on boards. We should be having them in local council areas to talk about services being closed and the impacts that that's going to have on their communities. And I think until we have that, we are always going to have that bounce back, because there isn't accountability. You'll go to your local authority will say it's Scottish Government, you go to Scottish Government and you'll say no, it's actually a local authority point. You then go back to your organisation and they'll say, well, there's nothing more we can do. And it's that bounce back that has caused, like, women especially to feel disillusioned with the political system and feel that they don't want to be part of it because they're not being listened to, they're not being taken, their human rights and the human rights of the others that they're looking after are not being taken into consideration, so why bother? So I think we really need to look at that.
A really big question, Fulton, and everybody has actually indicated they want to contribute, so if I can ask folk, time is against us to keep it tight, but I've seen Alan, Callum, Claire, Sarah, Una, and I think Gillian as well.
That's not a good question.
Apologies, I'll need to go because I've got another meeting just now. I'm really sorry not to stay for this, but I'm sure I'll hear the feedback. Sorry about that.
Thanks, Pam. Thanks, Alan.
Yeah, on finance, effectively. So the question about, you know, disjoint between policy and experience in the ground, I know. I want to apologise for saying it's not just about budgets, but it kind of is just about budgets. Like, you cannot deliver human rights with aspirations and best intentions, you deliver them with cold, hard cash. And when it comes to local funding in particular, the point the Alliance have made is, in our response, you know, we don't have a position on the exact rates or forms of taxation that should apply in Scotland. That's beyond our area of expertise. But that when it comes to local services in particular, there is a clear, massive problem with council tax as it's currently formulated. You know, there was a local tax commission in 2014, which issued a number of recommendations for potential replacement. Is that a tax that is fundamentally regressive? It's been regressive since it was created. It's gotten more regressive over time, not least because the property valuations it's based on come from 1991. I don't want to upset any members of the committee, but I wasn't even a year old then. It's in desperate need of reform. And because it is such a regressive tax, councils have been put in this kind of catch-22 situation where services are being cut. So if they don't increase council tax, then those services are cut. And people who are sort of most at risk in society are on the lowest incomes, and that is largely women, disabled people, people from ethnic minority backgrounds. They find themselves struggling because they're not able to access these services. But if the council puts up council tax by the level it needs to, and it can only change band D, it can't just put it on higher bands because of the multipliers, that increase then impacts on people on the lowest incomes the most, because the burden of council tax is falling on people at the lowest level. So that to me is sort of a key point, that we've got to change how funding is done, because the committee asked, you know, is funding, is revenue raised equitably? And it's not, and it's having a real ability on councils and particular ability to deliver on their human rights obligations.
Thank you. And Callum?
Policy actually often don't have an explicit human rights focus, indeed can undermine it. We had the recent example in the housing sector is we've had now a kind of rent freeze applied to the social and the private rental sector for the best intentions of trying to address the affordability concerns around the cost of living. But we also know if the rent freeze is continued into the next financial year, we see social landlords unable to invest in the quality of stock, unable to build more homes, unable to build homes of cultural adequacy, you know, really undermining the human rights. Affordability is a part of housing as a human right, but it's not the only part. There's much more multifaceted, and I think the speed in which that decision was made, and if it is continued, does potentially lead to undermining the human rights of not just tenants, but future tenants as well. So there's a bit around considering this in the round instead of rushing into decisions, which with the rent control policy would be CIH's position.
And Sarah?
Just to add to what others have said, when decisions are being made either about efficiency savings or cuts, which may become more likely in the current economic times, it's vital that the assessment process that goes into that looks from a human rights perspective, looks at the equalities perspective, and authorities need to be able to justify the decision making. So in the case of your constituency example, there should be a justification of that should be made publicly available. And that assessment should include a process that looked at where areas had most need and why the decision was made that one area was able to be cut over others, and how what data was used within that assessment process. So those pieces of information and assessments taking place where authorities are having to make these decisions should be made publicly available.
Okay, thanks. Claire?
I think one of the big things that we need to address is that human rights, like you said, they're often the goals and in our policies, but they're not the reality for people. And I think a lot of that comes down to a lot of people in decision-making roles at local councils, but also right holders. Do they know what their human rights are? Human rights can be seem really far removed from people, and in our work that's exactly the feedback we get from accountable duty bearers. They go, I don't know what human rights are, but I know we've got an obligation, to rights holders saying, I thought it was for the most extreme of circumstances, for example. So I think there's a lot of capacity building to be doing about rights, and that's about empowering people to know them, and then they can claim them. So for your example, and the constituents knowing that that is a right that they have, and to use human rights language to advocate and protect that right. I also think Alan touched on a really good point that I'm not sure that we've covered a lot in depth, though we've covered a lot, is that one of the key standards in human rights law is non-retrogressive. And I think, again, it links to my last point, do people know that we have that as a standard? And then when we're making these policy decisions and cuts are being made, we have to realise that we have to balance this with our international obligations that we have, that you can't go backwards and it must be progressive realisation. And finally, I think I've just talked about what Susan mentioned as well about diversity in the workforce. It's so important, and I think Susan said that perfectly, so I don't need to discuss that anymore. But adopting a human rights-based approach, using panel principles to things like service provision, so for example the mobility hub, by adopting that approach you will go through your accountability principle and you would have a direct route to redress from when something goes wrong or when something goes really wrong and it's going to shut. There should be accountable people named in who they are, and then that's who you take it to, and there's none of jumping about. It's his responsibility, it's their responsibility. And I think that's what is missing in a lot of these circumstances is accountability.
Okay, and Una, please.
Thank you. Agree with a lot of what Claire just said there, particularly around about accountability. I guess the one thing I would add to this is that, of course, you know, finances and money is important. We need money to be able to run and provide services. But I do think we are at slight risk of, you know, saying that if there isn't, you know, additional resource, then we can't begin this journey towards human rights. And actually, there are things that people can be doing now within existing budget allocation to begin that kind of progressive realisation around about human rights. When we talk to people with learning disabilities, one of the things that we hear regularly is just about poor treatment from services, whether that be, you know, health services or just any kind of service that people with learning disabilities access on a day-to-day basis. So there is something here actually around about culture change and about embedding human rights training in public services and actually working with the third sector and seeing the third sector as a collaborative partnership in that, in terms of potentially the delivery of training, etc. And actually where, you know, the public sector and also the third sector may be struggling in relation to budget allocation, actually about how you can use what you have to deliver some of this training and to embed that culture change that we actually need to see in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Gillian.
Brief. I think one of the points was around that sort of implementation gap, I guess. And I think, you know, there's often good intentions, whether it's national policy or locally, but actually achieving it, you know, it's not clear, you know, how do you achieve that or what revenue needs to be, you know, what funding needs to be required to do that and what the outcomes are and, you know, how you're actually going to go about that. And we find that quite a lot around our work. You know, I mentioned already around social care, but we'd looked at drug and alcohol services early this year as well. And again, you know, there's obviously a real focus on making improvements there. And around rights, but again, it's not clear, you know, how that's going to be achieved, what the outcomes are, how the, you know, what funding is going to be needed, and where it should be targeted. And again, back to that point around prevention, but I think just to sort of reiterate some of the stuff that Claire had said around the sort of human rights understanding, and Cal had mentioned as well around, around training as well, and the language, I think, you know, I think people find human rights a really difficult thing to understand, or it's a scary thing, but actually when you break it down to the panel principles, it's really understandable. And that's something we're trying to do within Audit Scotland internally, you know, around our corporate stuff as well, to get everyone kind of aware of that. So then we can then apply it to our audit work and then look at that across the public sector and try and make improvements there too and help, you know, sort of that share that understanding and how you go about it.
Thanks so much. Time is against us, unfortunately. I know all the committee members have further areas that we'd like to explore, but there'll be other opportunities. That's been really, really helpful to us. So thank you all for your time and your contribution today. So that concludes the public part of our meeting for today, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you.